Hello, everybody. Joel Colander here again with Rock Island Auction Company. I'm in the preview hall, so again, you'll bear with some background noises you may hear. We are making the final preparations for May Premier Firearms Auction. It's the 11th hour. It's the week of all the finishing touches, all the polish, all the glass. Everything's being touched up for people's arrival on Thursday, on preview day. And it is the 11th hour, but there's just one more video I wanted to make about the gun. Actually, there's like four. But there's one more that I have time to make before this auction comes, and that's on this incredible piece of machinery. It is the Gardner gun. Now, ever since I saw it on our production floor, ever since I saw it roll into the building, I knew I wanted to do a video on it. I've never seen one before in real life. You just see them on videos online, or you see them in books, and how fascinating they are. So I always wanted to see one. Here they are. Here it is. And I'm happy to say that it is just as fascinating in person as when I saw it online and when you see it in the books. It is just this brass steampunk contraption, and it really holds an interesting place in firearms development. It's not quite a Gatling gun, but it's not quite a machine gun either. It's not quite a rifle, but it's not exactly artillery either. It's this weird in-between place. Not only between categories, but chronologically it's in between things. And so for all these reasons, the Gardner gun is not one you see a lot of. And so we'll go into that a little bit later. But of course, they get their name from William P. Gardner. He was born in Ohio in 1843. He served with the Union Army as a captain for the 9th Ohio Volunteer Cavalry. He's listed as having a few odd jobs after the Civil War, customs inspector, architect. But in 1872, documents list him officially, his occupation, as inventor. And if you're listing your occupation as an inventor, you know you've either got something in the works or you've already got it coming. Well, William Gardner, of course, had something in the works. In 1874, he had a wooden version of the Gardner gun constructed, like a functioning prototype, a metal one shortly thereafter. But like most inventors, he has the prowess to conceive the idea, but unfortunately very little ability to produce said invention. So in 1875, he's going to Pratt and Whitney, not only for manufacturing, but to help him develop the weapon into something that might be considered for military adoption. Now, the single barrel actions you'll see very frequently, they're very, very early. That's what they tested, of course, with the U.S. Navy. Most of them are two-barrel versions. Later on, most of them would be enclosed. There are a few that are not enclosed barrels. And then there are five-barrel versions of the Gardner guns as well, with all five barrels along a horizontal axis. And then enter, with Pratt & Whitney, Edward G. Parkhurst. He is the assistant plant supervisor at Pratt & Whitney. And almost immediately after Pratt & Whitney get the Gardner gun, he begins making improvements on the design. And they're not small improvements. They're in pretty significant areas of the gun. You have huge changes to the firing mechanism. He made changes also to the loading, the extraction, the cooling system. He was one who designed some of these the water jackets for the barrels. He made lots of changes to it, except for the actual drive itself is still not under the Parkhurst patents, but under the Gardner patents. Now, this arrangement, where Gardner is getting a royalty for every Gardner gun that Pratt & Whitney sells, sounds like a fine arrangement, except that Pratt & Whitney isn't selling any Gardner guns. Those orders are not coming in. Now, Gardner views his failure on no small part that Pratt & Whitney have made so many changes with the Parkhurst patents to his design that that must be why the guns aren't selling. So in August of 1879, Gardner starts his own company, the Gardner Gun Company. So now the two businesses, using the same Gardner patents, are in direct competition with one another. With the Gardner building the gun on his own original patents, with Pratt & Whitney building the improved Gardner guns using the Parkhurst patents. So they are in direct competition, and compete they do. The next few years of the Gardner gun history read like sort of a who's who of significant military trials at the time. You have them competing for substantial contracts like Italy, lesser contracts like Switzerland, India, and then, of course, the big players, Great Britain and the United States. And so during these few years, the late 1870s, maybe even early 1880s, it is just military trials, requests for improvement from those military bodies, caliber changes, caliber requests, more trials. It is just one after another, and at the end, both Gardner and Pratt & Whitney don't have much to show for it. Now, this is despite Pratt & Whitney winning the gold medal at the 1878 Paris exhibition, and the Gatling gun coming in second. So these aren't a known commodity. These have been on some of the world's biggest stages in front of the world's like developed countries who are definitely purchasing armament, and it just can't seem to get a foothold. At the end of the day, the Gardner Gun Company's only sold about 720 versions of theirs built on the original Gardner patents to about four countries in Europe. Pratt & Whitney, on the other hand, managed to sell just 450 of the Gardner improved or the improved Gardner guns to Italy, and then they sold 21 over the course of several models to the United States government. I'm happy to say that this is one of the 21, just 21, sent to the U.S. government, only 11 of which are purported to exist today. Now, there is a light at the end of the tunnel, but it turns out that light was a train. In 1894, the U.S. military invites them to some trials, like one last hurrah. Unfortunately, it's going against machine guns that are now, that don't require manual operation. These are fully automatic machine guns like we think of when we think of the earliest machine guns, the Maxims, regular machine guns. And that sort of sounds the death knell for the manually operated machine guns like the Gardner, like the Gatling, like the Nordenfeldt. And just 1 month later, the Gardner Gun Company and all its inventory was sold to try to settle existing debts. So while that marks the end of the Gardner Gun Company, Pratt & Whitney are still able to produce their improved Gardner guns using those Gardner patents. And wouldn't you know it, several years later, May 27th, 1898, Pratt & Whitney gets an order from the Chief of Ordnance for 10 two-barrel Gardner guns to take part in the Spanish-American War. They produced 10 of them. They received that order in May. They produced 10 of them. They arrive in September, almost a month after a peace treaty had been signed. And then later, of course, the Treaty of Paris, which settled some things. So the Gardner guns were ordered. They finally got their order for 10 of them in the Spanish-American War, but too late to do any good. Now, of those last 10 guns ordered for the Spanish-American War, this is one of them. Not only one of the last 10 ever ordered, the only 21 ever ordered by the U.S. government, so it's one of the last 10, or the last shipment of 10, it's also one of just 11 still thought to be in existence. So if you're an early machine gun collector, the significance is monumental. If you're a U.S. military collector, you're not going to have too many opportunities to find a Gardner gun. And frankly, there aren't too many chances to take a look inside of one. So I want to do just that. We're going to bring a camera back and just look at the almost hypnotic mechanics of a Gardner gun. So here we are on the left side of the Gardner gun. I start over here because the right side really doesn't have many controls, bar for the large, of course, firing mechanism crank that we all know and love. Although a lot of these spots are, you see, replicated on both sides, so it makes me wonder if they could be constructed for right or left-handed shooters. The only things that aren't interchangeable are the sights, it would appear to be at this point. At least it would have even the potential. This is brass fitted here. The front sight, of course, is molded into the front, you know, portion of the muzzle, so those can't be switched. But it looks like everything else, there might have been that possibility. I did not see that in the research, so that is just a hypothesis at this point. Up front, we have our fire and safe. It's currently in the safe position, which allows you to turn it with nothing happening, no firing pins dropping to the inside mechanism. Up here is the fire position, which would basically just allow our firing pins to go. So just a little disconnector there. We're going to leave it on the safe position so that we can use this without any additional wear or tear to the gun. I should also mention that this is one of the Parkhurst improvements. Being able to cycle the gun without firing it. So you can just, if you know, rounds still in the gun or chambered, you'd be able to eject them safely with this mechanism. Other than that, you have a lot of standard tripod controls, which are also of Parkhurst design. You can adjust your rear sight range with this knob here. You can adjust, elevation here, gross windage, just with the turret in general. And those are all the controls there are on a Gardner gun. Now you have on top what's pretty reminiscent of a Bruce Feed magazine. This one held in place by this little lever here. You just simple push, and it's a simple spring with that, which holds it in its big brass frame. When I say reminiscent of a Bruce feed, it is just like so. You essentially have large portions of bullets either in their boxes or a wooden peg where they're held bullet side down. So the rear of the casings, the rims are sticking up. What you do is you slap that box in against this, over on that side, and then slide it down into your sort of channel of choice, where they will feed into a dual feeding mechanism here on the in the top of the Gardner. So looking down into the feed where those two channels feed, you can see these two huge cutouts in the brass for those 4570 government cartridges. I don't know about you, but that's just cool. Also, this gives us our first chance to look at the mechanism. So you can see one kind of has a, it's blocked off by brass, and the other you can actually see the bolt. That would be the left barrel firing, and the right one preparing. So then you're extracting the left, 180 degrees, boom. Now the right one has fired, and the left one has loaded a shot, because that one's, the left bolt is retracted all the way. Actually, probably the top from where you're viewing it. We give it another 180 degrees. You can see the bolt on the bottom retracting. The one on the left is now fired, and the right is now blocked off from any secondary bullets falling in. It has loaded one. The bolt is back and ready to go. But let's open it up and take a look up close and personal. So we've still got the magazine out of the top. We take this large knob on the back, and we're just, you can see it's just some big threads. Once it's all the way out, lift that up and see it in all its glory. What I want to do is rest that very carefully down at the top. You can see that selector mechanism that we were just looking at here as it alternates back and forth. Just a pretty simple piece of metal right there that's moving back and forth with some of the mechanics back here. Frankly, I'm just going to let these do the talking. It's a beautiful, almost hypnotic motion. You'll also see it stamped number 14, not only on the gun, but on many of the accessories as well. And again, this is in the safe position, so we're not dry firing this guy. But you can see everything going just the way it's supposed to. And again, these are the Parkhurst improvements. So you have these large cams coming back here, kind of controlling the forward and backward reciprocating motion, which you see on machine guns to this day. Remember, the Gatling was still, they were still thinking rotary. This is pretty innovative. You have shells being loaded, taken from the magazine, put in, fired, coming back out and extracted. So you have our extractor here, and finally kind of captured and pushed down, that not just depending on gravity for it to fall out the sides. Actually, on the Gardner, his shells would be ejected out the side. The Parkhursts were being mechanically assisted to fall out the bottom. And that's how it all works. And you can see just how those, how that assist happens just back here with a little mechanical knob. It is just a beautiful thing to see in action. So you can really get an idea of how poetic and how fluid and how fascinating this whole mechanism is. What a treat. Just as fit and tight as it was in the 1890s as it is today. Hopefully you find the Gardner gun and taking a look inside just as fascinating as I do. In fact, if you want to look inside of some of the other models, like the unimproved, like the Gardner patents and some of the later improvements, even the five barrel, we're going to throw a link up to VBBSMYT and their YouTube channel. They have some great 3D cutaways of these mechanisms working. I highly suggest you check them out after you subscribe, of course. Give their channel a subscribe to. That's really, really fascinating work. Again, this is in our May premiere firearms auction. You can check it out online. This will be sold during day two. Thanks for watching, everybody. Until next time, keep your powder dry.